Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Reaching for the Moon, A Short History of the Space Race by Roger D. Launius, read by Keith Sellon-Wright. Prologue. US-USSR Early Post-War Rocketry. Soviet rocket builders Sergei Korolev and Valentin Glushko had been rivals for years when they started working together at the end of World War II. Each had been excited by the prospects for rocketry early on. When he was a boy, Glushko had even corresponded with Russian spaceflight godfather Konstantin Tsiolkovsky. Both Glushko and Korolev went on to play key roles in rocket experiments in the 1930s. Korolev became a leading light in the Moscow rocketry organization GIRT, Grupa Izuchenia Reaktivneva Dvishenia, or Group for Investigation of Reactive Motion, and its successor, RNII, Reaction Propulsion Scientific Research Institute. Glushko worked there as well, but Korolev's ideas gained primacy, and he went on to build the RP-318, the Soviet Union's first rocket-propelled aircraft. Glushko worked in Korolev's shadow, his bullheadedness and egotism feeding his resentment at Korolev's success. However, in 1938, at the peak of Joseph Stalin's purges and before the RP-318 aircraft could make a rocket-propelled flight, Glushko and Korolev, along with other aerospace engineers, were imprisoned in the Gulag. Both had been denounced by two leaders of the RNII, Ivan Klemenyov and Georgi Langemak, for deliberately slowing the Institute's work and for anti-Bolshevik sympathies. Glushko played a role in Korolev's incarceration. In his testimony, Glushko, probably under duress, turned on Korolev. Korolev did the same in his testimony. Both went to the Butyrka prison, and Korolev was forced to work for Glushko. Their mutual loathing escalated in that environment as Stalin's great terror took its toll. Both Glushko and Korolev suffered in the Gulag, but when World War II began, they were sent to work camps to develop new military weapons. In 1941, Glushko was placed in charge of a design bureau for liquid-fueled rocket engines. Working together in 1944, even as their mutual antipathy continued, Korolev and Glushko designed the RD-1KHZ auxiliary rocket motor used on a Lavochkin LA-7R interceptor. Late in World War II, both Glushko and Korolev perceived the immense progress that Wernher von Braun's team had made with the V-2 ballistic missile in Nazi Germany. Beginning in 1944, Germany used the V-2 to rain down some 3,172 warheads on Western Europe. The success of this missile led Glushko and Korolev to approach Stalin and champion the development of their own ballistic missiles. In 1945, Stalin sent both men, Glushko was the more trusted of the two, along with other technical experts from the work camp, to Soviet-occupied Germany to investigate Nazi ballistic missile efforts. At first, Korolev was relegated to overseeing hardware salvage, while Glushko led efforts to interview dozens of V-2 engineers and technicians who still remained in Germany. But soon, Korolev began assisting with this as well. He quickly earned the trust of the Minister of Armaments, Dmitry Fyodorovich Ustinov. When Stalin signed the decree initiating development of Soviet ballistic missiles on May 13, 1946, Ustinov appointed Korolev director of the newly established Scientific Research Institute NII-88 to conduct ballistic missile development. He also appointed Glushko chief designer of his own bureau, the OKB-456, which was charged with rocket engine development, a position he held until 1974. Glushko's OKB-456, later NPO Energomash, would later design the 35 metric ton, 340 kilonewton thrust RD-101 engine that powered Korolev's early rockets. Glushko also built the powerful RD-170-RD-180 family of liquid propellant engines that have been used on many rockets around the world to the present day. The work of both Korolev and Glushko was central to the post-World War II ballistic missile race between the United States and the Soviet Union, as well as the space race to the moon. Both played critical roles not only in making the dreams of spaceflight real, but also in the nuclear terror made possible by intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBMs, between the 1960s and the 1980s. Korolev had 200 German employees at the Mittelwerk V2 factory rounded up on the night of October 22 to 23, 1946, and sent to relatively comfortable living quarters at Lake Seeliger between Moscow and Leningrad. The Germans had little direct contact with Korolev's engineers. They assisted in launching a few V2s from Kapustin Yar. Mainly, they answered written questions and were finally returned to East Germany between 1950 and 1954. Korolev copied the V2 design with Soviet components for his R-1 missile. These evolved during the 1950s into the successively more capable R-2 and R-5 missiles. Korolev received approval for development of the R-7 on May 20, 1954. Although preliminary ICBM development was approved while Stalin was alive on February 13, 1953. Again, Glushko built the engines that powered this missile. The Soviets successfully tested the R-7 on August 21, 1957, a two-stage ICBM with a maximum payload of 5.4 tons, sufficient to carry a Soviet atomic warhead 3,500 miles. While it was the world's first ICBM, the R-7 was an impractical weapon. It required enormous launch pads, complex assembly and launching procedures, cryogenic liquid oxygen oxidizer, and radio-controlled terminal guidance. Moreover, its range was impressive, but sufficient to reach only the far northern United States from a launch site in the Soviet Union. As a result, the Red Army deployed it as a weapon at only 8 launch pads in Tyratam and Plesetsk in the northern USSR. Development of more practical successors, such as Korolev's R-9, did not begin until May 13, 1959. The R-7 served well as an early space exploration vehicle, however, and it launched both Sputnik 1 and 2 into orbit in 1957 and served as the first human space launcher for Yuri Gagarin and German Titov in 1961. As much as anyone, Korolev led the Soviet effort to reach the moon with the sometime support of Glushko and the strong rivalry he provided. The death of Korolev in a botched medical procedure in early 1966 may have done more to retard the Soviet moon program than any other single setback. It certainly left Glushko in a position to assume leadership in the Soviet space program. An American counterpart to the frenemy relationship of Korolev-Glushko may be found in the careers of Robert R. Gilruth and Werner von Braun. During the latter part of World War II, leaders of the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, NACA, the predecessor to NASA, had become interested in the possibilities of high-speed guided missiles and the future of spaceflight. NACA officials created at the end of World War II the Pilotless Aircraft Research Division, PARD, under the leadership of Gilruth, then a young and promising engineer at the Langley Memorial Aeronautical Laboratory in Tidewater, Virginia. Gilruth established Wallops Island near the Virginia shore as a test facility under the control of Langley on July 4, 1945. From this site, the NACA launched between 1947 and 1949 more than 300 rockets of all sizes and types, leading to the publication of its first technical report on rocketry, Aerodynamic Problems of Guided Missiles, in 1947. From this, Gilruth and Pard filled in the gaps in the knowledge of spaceflight. In 1952, for example, Pard started the development of multi-stage hypersonic solid-fuel rocket vehicles. These vehicles were initially used primarily in aerodynamic heating tests and were then directed toward a re-entry physics research program. On October 14, 1954, Pard launched the first American four-stage rocket, and in August 1956, it launched a five-stage solid-fuel rocket test vehicle, the world's first, that reached a speed of Mach 15, 15 times the speed of sound. These strides in the development of rocket technology positioned the NACA as a quintessential agency in the growing importance in the 1950s of the quest for space. When the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, began operations in 1958, Gilruth accepted responsibility for its first signature program, Project Mercury, to place the first astronauts into orbit. Dottie Lee, the only woman engineer working in Gilruth's space task group, remembered him as this beautiful, brilliant man. "I worked in an office with perhaps 7 men, and I'm in my little corner," Lee recalled in an oral history in 1999. Gilruth stops at the door, and I can see him. The men are discussing something, trying to solve a problem, and he listens. Then he asks a question, which turned their thinking around and headed them down the right path. And he turned around with a smile on his face and walked out. He didn't tell them how to do it. He just asked a question. And I thought, why can't everyone be like this man? Gilruth went on to lead the space task group for NASA that accomplished Project Mercury, then served as director of the Manned Spacecraft Center, renamed the Johnson Space Center in 1973, which had suzerainty over Gemini and Apollo. His organization recruited, trained, and oversaw the astronauts and the human spaceflight program throughout the heroic age of spaceflight. Yet his name is much less well-known than many others associated with these projects. He was a contemporary on a par with von Braun, the technical director of the Nazi V-2 ballistic missile program, the rocketeer who built the first launcher sending spacecraft into orbit for the United States. Gilruth later built the NASA Center in Houston as the home of the space exploration and became its first director. In this position, he pushed hard to develop the human spaceflight program as a cohesive whole during the 1960s. His longtime associate, Chris Kraft, said of him at the time of his death in 2000, "He was the guy with the right thoughts in his mind, with the right kind of leadership, and had sense enough to get the right kind of people to do the right kind of job. And you can't say anything better about a man than that." Gilruth was an example of the engineering entrepreneur, a developer and manager of complex technological and organizational systems, accomplishing remarkably difficult tasks through excellent oversight of the technical, fiscal, cultural, and social reins of the effort. Johnson Space Center Director George W. S. Abbey offered this eulogy about Gilruth's career on NASA's behalf in 2000. "Robert Gilruth was a true pioneer in every sense of the word and the father of human spaceflight. His vision, energy, and dedication helped define the American space program. His leadership turned the fledgling manned spacecraft center into what it is today, the leader in humanity's exploration of outer space." A counterpoint to the career of Robert Gilruth in the United States was the experience of the handsome German émigré Werner von Braun, one of the most important rocket developers and champions of space exploration during the period between the 1930s and the 1970s. Raised on the science fiction of Jules Verne and H.G. Wells, as well as the scientific writings of Hermann Oberth and others, von Braun joined the German rocket society Verein für Raumschifffahrt, VFR, as a teenager in 1929. As a means of furthering his desire to build large and capable rockets, in 1932 he went to work for the German Army to develop ballistic missiles, and he worked throughout World War II building the liquid-propelled V-2 missile. His program's use of concentration camp labor from the Dora and Mittelwerk camps raised questions after the war of whether he might have engaged in war crimes. At 46 feet in length and weighing 27,000 pounds, the V-2 flew at speeds greater than 3,500 miles per hour and delivered a 2,200-pound warhead to a target 500 miles away. First flown in October 1942, it was used against targets in Europe beginning in September 1944. By the end of the war, more than 3,100 V-2s had been launched against Antwerp, London, and other continental targets. The guidance system for these missiles was imperfect, and many did not reach their targets, but they struck without warning, and there was no defense against them. As a result, the V-2 had a terror factor far beyond its capabilities. By the beginning of 1945, it was obvious to von Braun that Germany would not achieve victory against the Allies, and he began planning for the post-war era. Before the Allied capture of the V-2 rocket complex, von Braun arranged the surrender of his best rocket engineers, along with plans and test vehicles, to the Americans. Because of the intriguing nature of V2 technology, von Braun and his chief assistants were brought to the United States as part of Project Paperclip. Installed at Fort Bliss, Texas, they worked on rockets for the U.S. Army, launching them at White Sands Proving Ground, New Mexico. In 1950, von Braun's team moved to the Redstone Arsenal near Huntsville, Alabama, where it built the Army's Jupiter ballistic missile, a launcher capable of sending a small warhead a maximum of 500 miles. Von Braun also became one of the most prominent spokesmen of space exploration in the United States in the 1950s. In 1952, he gained note as a participant in an important symposium dedicated to the subject, and he burst on the nation's stage in the fall of 1952 with a series of articles in Collier's, a popular weekly periodical of the era. He also became a household name following his appearance on three Disney television shows dedicated to space exploration in the mid-1950s. He gained a greater status in the 1960s, however, when his rocket team at Huntsville, Alabama, transferred to NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center to build the mighty Saturn V rocket that took astronauts to the moon. Gilruth and von Braun, like Korolev and Glushko, worked together during the space race. Each needed the other to be successful, and their relationship was professional. They were sometimes in sync, but also often at odds. Dealings proved complex, rivalries ran deep, and achievements proved astounding. Neither of these leaders could have achieved the moon landings without the other. A symbiotic relationship evolved as NASA undertook Project Apollo in 1961. Couple this with the ballistic missile program taking place in the U.S. military services, and the stage was set for the beginnings of the space age. Throughout the 1950s, all the armed services worked toward the fielding of intercontinental ballistic missiles to deliver warheads to targets half a world away. By the late 1950s, therefore, rocket technology had developed sufficiently for the creation of a viable ballistic missile capability. This was a revolutionary development that gave humanity, for the first time in its history, the ability to attack one continent from another. It effectively shrank the size of the globe, and the United States, which had been protected from outside attack by two massive oceans, could no longer rely on that natural boundary. Its own capability, additionally, signaled for the rest of the world that the United States could project military might anywhere in the world. The ICBM program did something more. It helped in the maturation of technologies necessary for the space race. Robert Gilruth probably voiced the ultimate aim of all of these individuals during that period of ferment leading to the space race of the late 1950s through the 1960s. He commented in an oral history, "When you think about putting a man up there, that's a different thing. There are a lot of things you can do with men up in orbit." That goal prompted everything Korolev, Glushko, von Braun, Gilruth did from the 1950s on. It prompted a titanic race to the moon, in which either side might have been first, depending on how certain events turned out. These engineers undertook the building of rockets and other technology necessary to make space exploration a reality. Collectively, these individuals, and thousands like them, helped to make the dreams of spaceflight real. 1. Sputnik Winter. Few Americans considered the reception on Friday, October 4, 1957, at the Soviet Union's embassy in Washington, D.C., to be anything out of the ordinary. It was the appropriate culmination of a week-long set of international scientific meetings. It was also, in the cynical Cold War world of international intrigue between the United States and the Soviet Union, an opportunity to gather national security intelligence and engage in petty games of one-upmanship between the rivals. This reception, however, would prove far different. The one-upmanship continued, but it was far from petty. To a remarkable degree, the Soviet announcement that evening changed the course of the Cold War. Dr. John P. Hagen arrived early at the party. He wanted to talk to a few Soviet scientists, those he considered personal friends from long years of association in international scientific organizations, to learn their true feelings about efforts to launch an artificial satellite as part of the International Geophysical Year, IGY. Hagen, a senior scientist with the Naval Research Laboratory, headed the American effort on Project Vanguard, and the rocket was behind schedule and over budget. Was the same true of the Soviet Union, or would the satellite go up in 1958 as planned? Hagen had been through a ringer in the past week. Beginning on Monday, September 30th, the International Scientific Organization, known as CSAGI, Comité Spécial de l'Année Géophysique Internationale, had opened a 6-day conference at the National Academy of Sciences in Washington on rocket and satellite research for the IGY. Scientists from the United States, the Soviet Union, and 5 other nations were meeting to discuss their individual plans and to develop protocols for sharing scientific data and findings. Hints from the Soviets at the meeting, however, had thrown the conference into a tizzy of speculation. Several Soviet officials had intimated that they could probably launch their scientific satellite within weeks instead of months. Hagen worried that the offhand remark on the conference's first day by scientist Sergei M. Poloskov that the Soviet Union was on the eve of the first artificial Earth satellite was more than boastful rhetoric. What would a surprise Soviet launch mean for his Vanguard program and for the United States? Hagen wondered. Hagen did not have long to wait to learn the answer. The party had gathered in the second-floor ballroom at the embassy when a little before 6 p.m., Walter Sullivan, a science reporter with the New York Times, who was also attending the reception, received a frantic telephone call from his Washington bureau chief. Sullivan learned that the Soviet news agency TASS had just announced the launch of Sputnik 1, the world's first Earth-orbiting artificial satellite. When he returned to the party, Sullivan sought out Richard W. Porter, a member of the American IGY committee, and whispered, "It's up." Porter's ruddy face flushed even more as he heard this news, although he too had suspected Sputnik's imminent launch. He glided through the gaggles of scientists, politicians, journalists, strap-hangers, and spies in search of Lloyd V. Berkner, the official American delegate to CSAGI. When told the news, Berkner acted with the characteristic charm of his polished demeanor. Clapping his hands for attention, "I wish to make an announcement," he declared. "I've just been informed by the New York Times that a Russian satellite is in orbit at an elevation of 900 kilometers. I wish to congratulate our Soviet colleagues on their achievement." On the other side of the ballroom, Hagen's face turned pale. They had beaten the Vanguard satellite effort into space. Were they really the greatest nation on Earth, as Soviet leaders boisterously reminded anyone who would listen? Were they really going to bury us, as Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev had announced at the United Nations in 1960 as he pounded his fist and then his shoe on his desk? What could the United States do to recover a measure of international respect? At the IGY reception, the scientists immediately adjourned to the Soviet embassy's rooftop to view the heavens. They were not able to see the satellite with the naked eye. Indeed, Sputnik 1 twice passed within easy detection range of the United States before anyone even knew of its existence. The next morning at the IGY conference, the Soviet Union's chief delegate, Anatoly A. Blagonravov, explained the details of the launch and the spacecraft. The CSAGI conference officially congratulated the Soviets for their scientific accomplishment. But what was not said, but clearly thought by many Americans in both the scientific and political communities, was that the Soviet Union had staged a tremendous propaganda coup for the communist system, and that it could now legitimately claim leadership in a major technological field. The international image of the Soviet Union was greatly enhanced overnight. The inner turmoil that Hagen felt on Sputnik Night, as October 4th to 5th, 1957 has come to be called, reverberated through the American public in the days that followed. 2 generations after the event, words do not easily convey the American reaction to the Soviet satellite. The only appropriate characterization that begins to capture the mood on October 5th demands the use of the word hysteria. A collective mental turmoil and soul-searching followed as American society thrashed around for the answers to Hagen's questions. Almost immediately, two phrases entered the American lexicon to define time: pre-Sputnik and post-Sputnik. The other phrase that soon replaced earlier definitions of time was space age, for with the launch of Sputnik 1, the space age had been born and the world would be different ever after. The nature of Cold War competition. The Sputnik launch created such broad repercussions because of the long-standing difficult relations between the United States and the Soviet Union. From the time of the Bolshevik Revolution in October 1917 that brought Lenin and the Communists to power in Russia, the United States had resisted the creation of a state that sought to level society through wealth redistribution. American troops intervened to support more moderate Russian forces in the revolution. These efforts failed, and American troops finally evacuated Russia only in 1920. The United States also refused to acknowledge the legitimacy of the Soviet government until November 16, 1933, when President Franklin D. Roosevelt ended almost 16 years of American non-recognition of the Soviet Union following a series of negotiations in Washington, D.C., with the Soviet Commissar for Foreign Affairs, Maxim Litvinov. This active resistance by the United States to the establishment of the Soviet state created an environment of distrust. The Cold War that coalesced in the late 1940s rested on this long-standing situation and proved much more than just a military standoff. This rivalry between the United States and the Soviet Union manifested itself in an all-out competition between two divergent political and economic systems. While the United States and the Soviet Union were allied in World War II to defeat the Axis powers led by Nazi Germany, that alliance rested on the core understanding that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. No sooner had the Allies won that war than the nations returned to an uneasy relationship. After the war, these two rival nations nearly came to blows, and by that time each had nuclear weapons that could annihilate the other. The rivals squared off over the future of Central and Eastern Europe beginning in the late 1940s and lasting until the early 1990s. Accordingly, for nearly four decades, the Soviets and the Americans squared off in this Cold War. Virtually every place in the world was a potential flashpoint. The United States sought to contain the spread of communism outside of the areas controlled by the USSR at the end of World War II. In July 1947, the quarterly journal Foreign Affairs published an anonymous article entitled "The Sources of Soviet Conduct," which advocated a strategy of containment in dealing with the Soviet Union. Its author, soon revealed as U.S. State Department official George F. Kennan, proposed active opposition to any expansion of communist power. Kennan wrote, "We are going to continue for a long time to find the Russians difficult to deal with. It does not mean that they should be considered as embarked upon a do-or-die program to overthrow our society. Place Stalin, leader of the Soviet Union, in a box and limit his ability to do anything internationally." Containment became America's official strategy, and in seeking to accomplish it, the United States forged numerous alliances in Western Europe, the Middle East, and Southeast Asia. The strategy, however, engendered many controversies, some of which verged on erupting into full-scale wars. The Berlin Blockade, 1948 to 1949, the Korean War, 1950 to 1953, the Vietnam War, 1959 to 1975, the Cuban Missile Crisis, 1962, and the Soviet-Afghan War, 1979 to 1989, all served to heighten tensions. In at least one instance, the Cuban Missile Crisis, nuclear holocaust almost came to pass. There were also periods when tensions declined, especially during the détente of the early 1970s, when the nations opened more amiable relations. In the end, direct military actions were deterred by the potential for mutual assured destruction, MAD, certainly the most appropriate acronym ever dreamed up, since it referred to annihilation of both combatants through the use of nuclear weapons. By the time of the launch of the world's first artificial satellite in 1957, the United States and the Soviet Union each faced critical strategic challenges. Both were consumed by fears of an advance of the other into territories. The United States and its allies were on the watch for Soviet advances in Europe and Asia. The Soviet Union and its allies considered themselves surrounded by hostile nations led by an aggressive United States. The Soviets, moreover, had no bases close enough to American soil to strike should war break out, yet they felt threatened by a plethora of U.S. military capabilities based in Europe and Asia. Not until the rise of ballistic missiles would this change. Depending on how one viewed this geopolitical confrontation, either side looked surrounded. A polar projection map suggested that the Soviet Union was hemmed in by unfriendly forces, most of which were allies of the United States. Europe to the west, various Asian nations to the east, and after 1952, NATO allies such as Turkey to the south, all created nervousness in the Kremlin. That feeling of being boxed in proved psychologically powerful to Soviet leaders and helped to prompt a series of aggressive responses. In the early ballistic missile era of the late 1950s, moreover, the United States placed nuclear weapons on Jupiter missiles in Turkey and Italy and based strategic bombers in other parts of Western Europe and in Japan and South Korea. The seeming paranoia of the Soviet leaders, especially Joseph Stalin and his successor Nikita Khrushchev, may be partially explained by this sense of being crowded by hostile powers. They forever seemed to be seeking breathing room and buffer territory that could make the Soviet Union invulnerable to attack. A world map in a more common Mercator projection shows an expansion of the Soviet Union as a result of World War II. It depicts the belligerence of Stalin in subsuming Eastern Europe under Soviet control. Out of the war, the Soviets incorporated into the Russian sphere of influence much of Eastern Europe, including Poland, Czechoslovakia, Romania, East Germany, and other smaller nations. Struggles in Greece and other parts of Europe narrowly turned back communist takeovers. A theory of foreign relations emerged from this setting that was called the domino effect. Its proponents asserted that if one part of a region came under the influence of communism, then surrounding areas might well follow from revolutionary efforts sparked by the neighboring communist state. President Dwight D. Eisenhower accepted this theory, stating on April 7, 1954, "You have a row of dominoes set up. You knock over the first one, and what will happen to the last one is the certainty that it will go over very quickly. So you could have a beginning of a disintegration that would have the most profound influences." Successive U.S. presidents applied this idea to Soviet relations, justifying American intervention around the world in dealing with presumed threats from the Soviets. At the same time, playing on the fears Americans had felt for years of a Soviet threat to their way of life, the development of highly sophisticated nuclear weapons raised the stakes in this confrontation. And the Soviets felt the same way about the Americans. The United States had developed the first atomic bomb in World War II and had used it on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in August 1945, not only to force Japan's unconditional surrender, but also to demonstrate this devastating capability for Stalin. The Soviets followed by exploding their own atomic warhead in 1949. The Americans upped the ante in 1952 with the testing of the much more powerful hydrogen thermonuclear device, but the Soviets followed with their own test of a hydrogen weapon in 1953. It appeared as if the Soviet Union was overtaking the United States in the development of new and ever more powerful weapons. The launch of Sputnik in 1957 suggested that Americans had lost out to Soviet technology. Investment banker and Republican operative Frank Altschul wrote to President Eisenhower on this issue on October 8, 1957, outlining the loss of atomic supremacy, general deterioration in the position of the non-Soviet world, successful activities by the Soviet Union in the Middle East, crushing of anti-communist uprisings in Hungary and Czechoslovakia, communist forays into Southeast Asia, and a host of other apparent setbacks for the West. All of this created world doubt about the outcome of the Cold War for democratic nations in general and the United States as its leader in particular. Sputnik was the final straw in a long series of problems. Altschul suggested that the impression of impotence created by the failure of the Western world to find practical measures to counteract overt acts of Soviet aggression made this a crisis. The International Geophysical Year and the Origins of the Space Age. The International Geophysical Year, IGY, served magnificently as a vehicle for the birth of the space age. The genesis of the IGY was a dinner party in the home of scientist James A. Van Allen in Bethesda, Maryland, in the summer of 1950. This event has taken on legendary status as everything from a nearly mystical gathering to the reaffirming of the authority of science in modern life. At some level, the IGY may be viewed as a cabal led by Van Allen, British physicist Sidney Chapman, and American science entrepreneur Lloyd V. Berkner to hoodwink the nations of the world into pursuing an aggressive scientific program to ensure funding and status for activities never dreamed of before. At another, it may be interpreted as cagey politicians manipulating the scientific community to provide a stalking horse for the resolution of a thorny geopolitical problem. Indeed, it is both of these. Pressed by Berkner, the International Council of Scientific Unions, ISCU, agreed in 1952 to pursue a comprehensive series of global geophysical activities to span the period July 1957 to December 1958. 67 nations agreed to conduct cooperative experiments to study solar-terrestrial relations during a period of maximum solar activity in 1957 to 1958. In October 1954, at the behest of essentially this same group of U.S. scientists, ICSU challenged nations to use missiles being developed for war to launch scientific satellites to support the IGY research program. In response to ICSU's announcement on May 26, 1955, the National Security Council, NSC, the senior defense policy board in the United States, approved a plan to orbit a scientific satellite as part of the IGY effort. The NSC's endorsement was provisional. The effort could not interfere with the development of ballistic missiles, it must emphasize the peaceful purposes of the endeavor, and it had to contribute to establishing the principle of freedom of space in international law. Eisenhower supported this effort, and on July 29th, publicly announced plans for existing organizations within the Department of Defense to develop and launch a small scientific satellite under international auspices such as the International Geophysical Year in order to emphasize its peaceful purposes. Considerable prestige and psychological benefits will accrue to the nation which first is successful in launching a satellite, especially if the USSR were to be the first to establish a satellite. There followed a heady competition between the Naval Research Laboratory on the one hand and the Army's Redstone Arsenal, where von Braun led the effort to win permission to develop the IGY satellite. Project Vanguard, proposed by the Navy, was chosen on September 9, 1955, to carry the standard in launching a non-military satellite for the IGY effort over the Army's Explorer proposal. The decision was made largely because the Naval Research Laboratory candidate did not interfere with high-priority ballistic missile programs. It used the Viking launcher as its basis rather than a ballistic missile, while the Army's bid was heavily involved in those activities and proposed adapting a ballistic missile for the purpose. In addition, the Navy rocket seemed to have greater promise for scientific research because of a larger payload capacity. The Viking launch vehicle was also a proven system. An early version of it had first flown in the late 1940s, while the Army's proposed rocket, the Redstone, had been launched for the first time only in August 1953. Finally, the Naval Research Laboratory's proposal was more acceptable because it came from a scientific organization rather than from a weapons developer, in this case, the Redstone Arsenal. Although he approved the IGY satellite, Eisenhower was cost-conscious about the program, especially as it seemed to grow in cost and complexity with every review. He repeatedly wondered about its voracious appetite for public funds, especially since Vanguard supposedly took a backseat to real national security space activities, most notably the accelerating program to develop ballistic missiles. From its initial cost estimates, Vanguard had mushroomed to a cost of $67.9 million by August 1956 and to $110 million by the summer of 1957. During the next several months, the Eisenhower administration became increasingly concerned with the tendency of Project Vanguard to get bogged down. Eisenhower was especially concerned about the probability that the scientific instruments were slowing it down. About 5 months before the Soviets orbited Sputnik 1, the president reminded his top advisors, as his aide Andrew Goodpaster recorded, "Such costly instrumentation had not been envisaged," and the president stressed that the element of national prestige depended on getting a satellite into its orbit and not on the instrumentation of the scientific satellite. Eisenhower's perception of the budgetary growth of the Vanguard program, transforming it from the simple task of putting any type of satellite into orbit into a project of launching a satellite with considerable instrumentation, reminded him of the worst type of technological inflation, as every scientist seemingly wanted to hang another piece of equipment on the vehicle. Von Braun and his Huntsville rocket team truly believed that they should have received the mandate to build and launch the first American satellite. Having lost the Vanguard program, however, they pushed for their appointment as a backup plan in case Vanguard was unsuccessful. As the Vanguard program ran into technical difficulties, furthermore, von Braun pressed for permission to launch ahead of the rival effort, claiming he could place a satellite in orbit as early as January 1957. The Department of Defense turned down that request, making the announcement in a memorandum of July 5, 1956. While it is true that the Vanguard group does not expect to make its first satellite attempt before August 1957, whereas a satellite...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.